Welcome to the BioWolf Bash scripting class. In this section, we will go over processes to complement our experience with commands in Bash. Let's start with a quick overview of the Linux kernel. You may have already heard us mention the kernel. It is the heart of the Linux operating system. It provides an interface between the hardware and the shell. While this class is all about the shell, hardware, on the other hand, includes one or more CPUs, the available memory, disks, devices, etc. One of the primary functions of the kernel is to manage processes, which is what we focus on in this section. How do processes come about? When you type a command on the shell prompt and hit the return key, the command is sent for execution. First step is for the shell, here the bash shell, to interpret the command and create machine-readable instructions. These instructions go to the kernel, and it starts a process and assigns the process an ID called the process ID or PID. The process uses hardware resources like CPU and memory. All along, the kernel is responsible for managing the process. Here's another schematic showing the place of the kernel in relation to the user, shell, hardware. This class focuses on the bash shell, shown here. Users interact with the shell using a keyboard. The shell interfaces with computing resources through the kernel as it manages processes started by the users. Let's dig deeper into processes. A process is a running instance of a program. Bash commands like echo, date, ls are all examples of programs. When you execute the command, the program runs as a process. In other words, processes carry out tasks. Linux is a multiprocessing operating system, meaning that multiple processes can be run simultaneously. The kernel is responsible for handling these. Each process is in a way independent of the other. If a process crashes, it will not cause another process in the system to crash. But processes can still interact with each other using kernel-managed mechanisms. In general, there are two types of processes. Ones that run in a terminal session are foreground processes and are often interactive in nature. Processes not connected to a terminal are background processes and are not interactive. Users can monitor processes with a variety of tools like PS and TOP. Let's see how we can use PS. Here we are on the bash prompt logged into BioWolf. Simply entering the PS command without any options or flags shows a point-in-time snapshot of processes the logged-in user is running. Here you can see the running process bash and PS, the command we just executed. The first column shows the process ID or PID assigned by the kernel. The second column is the console or terminal identifier where the user is logged in and running commands. The time column is the amount of CPU time taken by a process. This is different from clock time or wall time. While a process is being executed by the kernel, the CPU isn't always being utilized as a resource. Other time-consuming parts of a process include waiting for disk or network input/output, but these are not included in the time column since these are unrelated to the CPU. R2 processes have taken zero or negligible time on the CPU. Before we go further, I want to introduce the sleep command. Sleep is a way to add a pause or delay. It will be helpful here in demonstrating what PS can do. Sleep takes an integer argument for the number of seconds to delay. Let's start with 5 seconds. We wait 5 seconds to return to the prompt. And here we are. I've mentioned background processes. Users can also run background processes by ending a command with the ampersand character and then hitting the return key. Let's try sleep for 500 seconds, but this time we will run it in the background while we explore with PS. We get the prompt back instantly after the terminal shows us the PID for the sleep process. So let's try PS again. Now you can see the running sleep process. The U option without a hyphen to PS gives us more information. Let's see what that looks like. Now we see additional fields like user, which shows the name of the user running the command. %CPU and %mem will give you information about CPU and memory usage. VSZ and RSS are the virtual and resident set sizes, respectively. These are the memory sizes assigned to and currently being used by a process. The stat field gives us the status of the process. A status S means the process is sleeping, waiting for an event to complete. The capital S lowercase s status on the bash process marks it not only as a sleeping process, but also as a session leader. The R status is for a running process when PS captures the information. The plus sign indicates it is a foreground process. There are quite a few process state codes, and I'll show you more later after this demonstration. You can also find process state codes in the PS manual. Finally, the start field gives us the time at which the process began. Another useful PS flag is the F flag, which shows us a process tree. Let's see what that looks like. We'll combine F with U. Now we see the relationship between the processes. The PS and sleep commands are processes started inside the bash process. As a result, the bash process is the parent of both PS and sleep. To demonstrate more about process trees, let's start a new bash session with the bash command. Now let's look at the process tree. Here the session leader is a bash process on the top of the PS output. It is a parent of two processes, the sleep command we ran earlier and the new bash terminal we just started. This new bash process is the parent of the PS command we just ran. If I enter the exit command, I can terminate the new bash shell, and this returns the process tree to what it looked like before. As a final note before I end this demonstration, the sleep process I'm running in the background will terminate when I log out of my shell session on BioWolf. Most shells are configured to send a hang-up signal to processes owned by a user if the user is no longer connected to the shell terminal. Now we have a better understanding of processes and how they are related to the bash shell. Here are some of the different process state codes and their meanings. This was taken from the PS manual. R is for a running or runnable process. S indicates the process is waiting or sleeping. D, on the other hand, indicates that a process is stuck waiting for an I/O event and will not respond to signals. We actively monitor processes in D state for jobs in BioWolf, and you can see this on the user dashboard, as in this example. The T state indicates a process has been stopped by a signal. X state processes are not observed in PS output, as these processes are dead. But processes in Z state, or defunct processes, are already dead processes that are yet to be cleaned up by the parent. The lowercase s state tags the process as the session leader, L indicates a process is multi-threaded, and the plus sign indicates a process is running in the foreground. We have touched on many concepts in this section. We started with an overview of the kernel and its functions. Then we talked about processes, what they are and how they behave. We also touched on the types of processes and then explored processes using the PS command in the demonstration. There we saw process trees and learned about different process states. I encourage you to explore other sections in this course to get more in-depth coverage on the bash shell. If you have any questions or comments regarding the class, feel free to email us at staff@hpc.nih.gov. Thanks for watching and following along.